Now, Justice Kate O'Regan has been appointed to oversee the tracing of those who have contracted COVID-19. And she joins us now via Skype from Cape Town to tell us all about it. Justice O'Regan, thank you very much for your time. You were appointed by our Justice Minister, Ronald, Lamola, as our COVID-19 designate judge. Could you tell us exactly what your remit is?
Yes. Well, one of the things that government wants to do in order to tackle the pandemic is to compile a register of all the people who have tested positive. In fact, all the people who have tested, all the people who have tested positive, and their known or suspected contacts in order to undertake a track and tracing program to seek to contain the spread of the epidemic.
All right. So your remit is limited just to the issues around contact tracing.
That's correct. And in fact, to a very narrow aspect of those, because one of the ways in which government's going to get most of that information from laboratories, from hotel accommodation, from people who are going to inform government of people who have tested or who are staying with them. But there is one aspect of this where government can approach cell phone service providers and ask cell phone service providers to provide them with the location of people who are on the register at any time from the 5th of March 2020, which I imagine is the date in which government feels the spread of the virus began in South Africa, until the end of the disaster period. That's an invasive power in relation to privacy, because government can do that without getting the consent of the individual service provider, the individual cell phone user. And the cell phone providing companies are going to have to provide that information under the obligation imposed upon them in the regulations.
Now, I interviewed Amnesty International last night, and they were saying that a number of countries are doing exactly this to try and get in front of the disease. They have welcomed the appointment of a judge to actually oversee this process to make sure that the invasion, as you say, is not misused in any way. At what point in that process will you come in, and what sort of decisions will you be called on to make?
So, effectively, no decisions at all. But what I will be called upon to do is I'll be provided weekly with a list of all the people that are being tracked and traced. And I'll also be able to provide recommendations to three key ministries. So the Ministry of Cooperative Governance and Traditional Affairs, Ministry of Health, who will be responsible for compiling the register, and the Ministry of Justice, in order to find ways to minimize privacy risks that are going to be created by this novel power. And I suppose what one should add here is that we're in untested waters. Really, we'd never seen a global public health crisis of this magnitude since the emergence of an international human rights law framework from after the Second World War. So countries all over the world are grappling with how to make sure that they respect the human rights of their citizens and residents, but at the same time do everything they can to protect the health of citizens and residents by containing the spread of the virus.
Well, a couple of the issues that were raised by Amnesty International is to make sure that this information isn't stored forever, that certain aspects of it are not accessed forever, that it is actually, in fact, deleted after a period. Have the regulations around this contact tracing gone into that sort of detail, and is it transparent and open for us all to understand it?
Yes, the regulations are very clear on this, that the data that is collected must be removed within 6 weeks of the end of the disaster. Save that data will also be de-individualized and made available for research purposes. Obviously, once again, with a global crisis like this, it is very important. Science is kind of playing catch up, and public policy is having to be made. Most unusually in circumstances where the scientific level of knowledge is still in its infancy. So I think that the reason the government has taken the view that the database will be, the names will be deleted from the database, but it will be available for research purposes. It will be de-individualized in 6 weeks after the end of the disaster. Not only that, however, but every single person who actually has been on the database and subject to tracking and tracing, even though they may not have known that during the process itself, will be informed within 6 weeks of the end of the disaster. And I think that's an assurance to citizens that they will know about what government has been doing in this time in terms of tracking and tracing. Of course, many of them, if tracking and tracing work, will presumably be, in fact, contacted by public health officials in order to ensure what their health situation is, because they may have been at risk of having been in contact with somebody who has tested positive for COVID-19.
Justice, you're saying that it is an unusual time that we are in, and it certainly is. You, as a former constitutional court judge with a strong human rights background, does this create any cognitive dissonance, any difficulty for you that you have to navigate an invasion and a curtailing of individuals' rights?
Well, in a sense, here we've got two rights at play, haven't we? We've got a right of access to health, which our constitution protects in Section 27, and we also have the right of privacy. And it's always in those circumstances where trying to find the right balance is important. And I think we're all learning here. This is, as I say, it's novel for all of us. The scale of this we've never seen before. And I think that what we will be trying to do over the next little while is think about ways to make sure that privacy is protected, but that the job government wants to undertake in containing the virus is also not is also let happen. So yes, I think that it's new for all of us, and I think if you told us this 2 months ago, we would all have found it hard to believe. But I think it needs rapid response, and all of us to be thinking fresh about how to address this problem.
You said earlier, I think, that from the 1st of March, cell phone records will be accessed, so they'll go back and look at where people who they now know are positive may have moved, so they can go into those areas. Does that mean your work has already begun? And also, at what point could you say, no, that's not going to happen? Do you have those sorts of powers?
Yes. So, firstly, the date is the 5th of March. Secondly, the work has not yet begun, because I think this process of building this database is now going to commence, and I would expect sometime within the next week to receive from the Department of Health the first tranche, as it were, of information about people whose information has been received from the cell phone companies, and therefore it's only location. I think another point to your listeners, which is very important, is that all that is being got from cell phone companies is their location. There's a specific provision in the regulations that the content of any communications may not be sought. So it's limited to your location. And in relation to the powers of the judge that's appointed myself, there are no powers to stop government doing anything. Those will be issues that may, if people consider that there are issues of constitutionality or issues about which they're concerned, they'll need to approach ordinary courts in that regard. But my powers are really to be able to determine, to understand what's happening, and to be able to make recommendations to government as to how to make sure that the way in which government is conducting itself in seeking to contain the virus impairs privacy as minimally as possible.
So what would happen in a situation if you become uncomfortable about the way something is being done?
Well, that's a good question. You can be fairly clear that I will say to government if I think that something is awry, I will certainly make that clear to government that that is so. I have also agreed with the minister that if at any stage I think it is important that recommendations that I've made to government are made public so that people can know about them, that I will be able to do so and that I shall do so. So I do want the public to know that if I am uncomfortable about anything, I shall certainly, and I feel that it would be appropriate to make those recommendations and advice to government public. I will do so.
Thank you so much for your time. We really do appreciate it. That was Justice Kate O'Regan. She is our COVID-19 designate judge. She is overseeing the contact tracing, whereby the Department of Health is going to try and make sure that everyone who's COVID-19 positive has been traced. People who've come into contact with them are tested so that they can control the spread of the disease.